G'day, I'm Mark from Self-Sufficient Me, and I want to take you guys through some of the questions I've been getting lately on keeping quail. It's a really hot day here, it's about 38 degrees. Luckily, this quail pen is in the shade down here in my chicken area and poultry area, ducks as well. So it's not too bad, and I've got plenty of fresh water that I've topped up, and it gave them some extra water actually as well to dip a beak in, and not just the nipple waterers, but also a dip water that they can get a bit wet and play in. They've got plenty of dust to dust bath in and keep cool. So it's not too bad, but out in the sun, I tell you what, I am roasting, so I'm just dripping with sweat. But what I want to do is answer about 15 questions, and let's get stuck into answering these questions. All right, I'm nice and comfortable. Let me get these glasses on. All right, these are in no general order, and I'll try to be as succinct as possible, but you know me, I can ramble on a little bit sometimes, so apologize. This one, the first one is from DD001. What do you do when a few eggs crack slash die on day 12? All right, this question relates to the brooder and incubator series that I was doing not long ago. And the best way I suppose to answer it is, if you're candling your eggs or you're watching them through the incubation process, and say you get to day 12, I'm not sure why you selected day 12. Maybe I said this is day 12 in the video, I can't remember. But if I come across a cracked or an egg that has dried out or is not looking too good, or I've candled it and it's not growing and it doesn't have an embryo forming inside, you can't see any blood vessels and that type of thing, well, I just discard them. Because it's no use keeping them in the incubator, because all that'll do is possibly die off. If it explodes and goes putrid, it will send the rest of the eggs, or it could send the rest of the eggs bad. It could introduce bacteria, you know. So that's what I do, I discard them. Now, in general, pardon these birds going off, I'm afraid you're gonna have to put up with that. In general, I'm not a real big candler of my eggs. I believe in not disturbing the eggs too much. So if I'm gonna candle at all, I will candle only maybe once throughout the process at about day 10, between 7 to day 10. I think after 7 days you should have some idea if those eggs are growing, and if you see the eggs that are clear and that aren't growing, well then I'd get rid of them and only keep the ones that are growing. But having said that, there's periods where I don't candle at all. I just go and I check the eggs and I look. If I see any that are broken or no good, well then I'll discard them. And if I don't see any issues through the eyeball method, I'll just let them go to full term, because as it is with quail incubation, it's not a very long time anyway. It's between 16 to 18 days and they hatch out. So it's not really a big long period. And if some of the eggs aren't going to hatch at all, I've found they don't usually spoil the bunch. This is getting friggin' ridiculous. I can't hear myself over these birds going off. I think they feel that I'm a threat in here. So we're gonna have to answer these questions outside of the cage somewhere, because this is driving me nuts. Hello, this is much more comfortable. I don't know why I didn't think of this in the first place. I guess I just thought we'd do it in the quail pen because you could see the birds walking around me and that, but it's just way too noisy, isn't it? All right, let's go on to the second question from Jeanette Dory. Hi, Jeanette. Do you breed the quail for eating and selling? Sorry if my comments so many times is a pain, but as you talk about things, I feel the need to comment or ask things. Laugh out loud. Don't apologize about asking questions. The only thing is, I sometimes feel guilty that I don't get onto these questions fast enough. Yeah, you have to appreciate, guys, that I get not millions, but quite a few. Like, for example, yesterday I spent 3 hours trying to catch up on a week's worth of comments and questions. I like to read all the comments because I just feel that it makes me a better content provider and YouTuber, and also I want to answer those questions. Some people have some not needy questions, but some specific questions that they want a fairly quick answer to, so I really like getting onto it if I can, but sometimes I inevitably miss them, and I'd love to answer everything, but sometimes I just can't. But anyway, yeah, eating and selling. No, I don't sell. Well, yes and no. No, I don't sell the quail. The reason why I got into keeping quail in the first place was for pretty much ourselves, and also to give away or family and friends and have a barbecue, and we eat some quail. So yes, I do eat them. The primary purpose for this type of poultry is to eat. They only live for about 2.5 years. It's a bit like fish, you know. Quail in many cases don't live even as long as fish do. And so they're a very fast type of poultry breed to keep breeding. And they're primarily bred as a meat bird. Yes, you can eat the eggs, but as far as eating quail goes, that's the main reason for keeping them. They're a very nice eating bird. They're a quality meat. They're a gourmet meat, especially kept the way we do, free ranging practically, in a nice big cage. They're not farmed in small tiny cages where they can't hardly walk or anything. So we keep them in a really good environment, and that's what the whole point of backyard farming is growing produce, whether it be animals or fruit and veg, as clean and organically and as humanely as you possibly can. Next question from Richard's Homestead. I just got to put my glasses on. I'll probably fog up in this heat. Underneath this shade is quite nice. I don't know, I think, if you have been asked. I have not watched all your videos, although this one is well made. Oh, thank you. Have you had many predators breaking in? In this quail pen, no. We've had no predators at all breaking in. But I have seen dozens of attempts of break-ins, and they've all failed. I once saw a hawk with its talons against the mesh trying to get through to a quail that was quite close. Of course, it couldn't get through the mesh at all because it's really hard aviary wire. I saw an owl one night on the edge of the cage trying to figure out how to get in. Not a chance. There's been numerous snakes and pythons up against the cage in the morning, and of course rats and mice have tried to penetrate the pen but can't. Even if they've tried to nest in the roof cavity, they haven't been able to get through the mesh because I've meshed the whole thing in, and I've dug it down about a foot. And I think there's another question similar to that coming up, so I'll just save my answer. The next question, Nicholas Martin. How big is the quail pen? It's 7.2 metres long by 2.4 metres wide. So if you look at a metre as a yard slightly bigger than a metre, so say 7 yards by 2 metres, by 2 yards across. So it's a fairly large quail pen. I could keep, you know, 100 birds in there really if I wanted to, would still be okay, but I tend to keep under 50 at all times. Next question, Leon Mandy Battersby. Hello, I'm looking to get a young quail, but I have never had one before. It will be being kept indoors, and I was wondering what type of setup you would recommend, and if I can keep two of the same sex together. Also, are they easy to sex? Thank you. Mandy from the UK. Well, Mandy, Yeah, I've got a cousin who keeps quail indoors as pet, has one or two. Two is always good, I think, although quail tend to be a fairly individual type bird. But I just think, yeah, most animals do like to have another one there as company. I would probably keep two females together because, as you could hear before, the males can be really noisy. And I've done a video about this. Are quail, you know, will they annoy the neighbours? So you can have a look at that video. I'll put a link below in the description and maybe even on a card up here. But yeah, so two females I'd keep if I was inside, because they have a little call. It's like a frog and it's quite cute. Bloop, 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 bloop. Sort of like that, more a bit like a cricket. Not as good as what my impression is, but so yeah, keeping females would be the way to go. Female quail. As far as keeping them, the type of setup, I would go like a bird cage or like a guinea pig cage, actually, because they're almost like a guinea pig. They don't fly much, and so they like a fair bit of floor space and put mulch on the floor or pellets or whatever, some type of mulch that they can play in. Sand is good as well, so that they can play and throw the dust around and have a dust bath and that type of thing. And it also soaks up the manure and the wetness from the quail. But yeah, they'd keep as quite good pets. Be mindful though, they don't live for a very long time. They're only a small bird with a small heart, and they can sort of drop over any moment after a couple of years. Next question from Hunter Thompson Vlogs. I live in a suburb and want quail. Should get females or females and a male? Yeah, I answered that one in the one before. In the question before, yeah, I would get females for sure living in the suburbs. Again, see my video on are quail noisy. Owen Harris, another great video. Thanks, Mark. Do you use quail eggs in the kitchen? Not very often. We prefer chicken eggs over quail eggs. Quail eggs tend to be a little richer, but what they are great for is if you're going to a party or you're having a party and you want some hors d'oeuvres, yeah, you can just boil some quail eggs up and make deviled quail eggs or pickled quail eggs, and they are very nice eaten as a sort of special snack. But generally in cooking, we much prefer chicken eggs, and we've got plenty of chicken eggs. Next question from Rubber Hunter Slingshots. What grains are in quail feed? Well, there's a lot of different grains. I feed mine a game bird feed, which is pelletized. And in that pelletized feed, you've got things like wheat, sorghum, canola, oats, peas, lentils, beans, barley, and sunflower. So quite a few different grains all mashed up together to get a nice range of nutrients and a good hit of protein for this type of bird. Because it's a game bird, it needs more protein than most domestic chickens, say. Next question from Timur Hafus. Hi Mark, could you please tell me where I can buy the game bird feed you showed in this video? I've asked a few pet stores, but no one seems to know. Yeah, that's a question I get quite a bit too, is where do you get this feed from? And the thing is, quail aren't that popular. Well, not in Australia anyway. And it doesn't, for the commercial feed stores, the general pet stores that you can get in the malls or around the shops, the standard shops, they're not going to stock a quail or a game bird feed because it's not worth their while and it'll go off on the shelves. What you're best off doing is going to a stock feeds produce store. So a produce store for stock feed, where they sell, you know, pig feed, horse feed, and all different types of feed for domestic livestock. And you get them around country areas or the fringes of the city, or you can order it in online. And that's the best way to do it. I know a couple of the guys that I go to. I have two different stock feed places that I go to around here. Both of them stock it almost just for me. You know, I know one guy at the feed store down the road here, I'm pretty well his only quail customer, and so he'll get two or three bags in, you know, only, and he'll know that I'll use them up over a period of time, and otherwise he might not even stock it. So you can ask your stockist if they can get it in for you on a regular basis. Next one from Ozark Mountain Girl. How you going? Hi Mark, long time no see. My quail are doing great. I have about 55 now, well, excellent. Moving to a new farm and building pens now for chickens and quail. For now the quail are on wire, but soon we'll have a large run. Excellent. I'm thinking of putting 1/4-inch wire on the bottom, even though it will be on the ground, but we'll try to keep snakes and rodents out and still mulch on top to encourage bugs and allow them to scratch. I do a little different in the way I sell most my chicks. I sell most my chicks. I began culling as well as keeping only birds that have reached mature weight of above 9 ounce at 10 weeks old, trying to increase the size on my breeding stock and live up to that 10 ounce Texas A&M are supposed to do. Do you have wire on the bottom of your run? All right, you've only asked really one question there. Do you have wire on the bottom of your run? So I'll deal with that first. No, I don't. And I can tell you now I've tried it and it doesn't work very well at all. What happens is, when you've got wire on the bottom of a cage that's off the ground and they poop through the wire, that's fine. That'll last many years, a decade or so, no problems or more. But once you get that wire onto the ground, the quail, when the manure comes out, and it's a very high, it's even worse than chicken manure, quail manure, it's very high in ammonia, and it'll start rusting that galvanized mesh. Even if it's really good quality galvanized mesh, it'll start rusting it out because it mixes with the soil and all the minerals in the soil. It will oxidize that metal, and it's also kept damp because it's staying on the ground, and it won't be long and it'll all rust out on you, and it'll be a real mess in the pen. The other thing that's a problem with keeping mesh on the ground is when you go to rake the pen up and change the mulch and all that, your rake will get stuck, it'll be a pain, it'll lift up in places, it can trap birds when it gets rusty and starts to peel out, so I wouldn't recommend it. What I've done in my pen is I've dug the mesh down the walls, and it's lasted many years like that, and it's still going strong. I've dug it down into the soil. If I was to do it again, I would have cemented that mesh. I've dug it down 1 foot. But yeah, that's what I would do. I would dig a trench around the whole quail pen. I would double your wire over, use a really good quality galvanized mesh, cement it in. So you only have to have a thin trench, cement it in just so that it helps preserve that wire. And that will be suffice. Then you can have a good flat floor, you can rake it up, you can throw soil on it, you can let the manure and everything and the mulch decay down, and you won't have any worries with it. That's what I'd be doing if I was building a pen again from scratch. There was something else that I wanted to chat about. Oh yeah, I know a few breeders that practice that culling method of selective breeding, where you keep the quail that are growing to the largest, and you keep doing that until you get good sized quail. Yeah, that's fine. The only thing with selective breeding is don't go too overboard, because if you grow your quail, keep getting them as big as you can. What happens is their poor little knees buckle in and they get all crippled, and look, put it this way, eating an undersized quail isn't a real bad thing. It's not the end of the world. They still make for a good meat, and trying to get them as big as possible at all costs is hardly worth the effort, is what I'm saying. But I understand that you want to grow them to a nice, you know, 10 ounce size, whatever it is, that's fine. Okay, Kayla Foster. They're so cute, but how do you know if it's a boy or a girl? It's really easy with standard Courtenay's quail, because the females have a spotted chest, and they're generally a little bit bigger, whereas the males have a collar, like a rooster collar, like it's dark or brown, and it's obvious. And if you tip them upside down, though, say if you're looking at a tuxedo or a A&M, and you can't readily tell because it's not the original Japanese quail colours, well then tip them upside down. The male will have a pronounced genitalia. Sometimes it won't be as pronounced as you'd want. But the way to check is if you just push on the genitalia just slightly, you'll see a white foam come out. And that white foam signifies the sperm or the lubricant from the male, and you'll know that that's definitely a male. If you turn the hen over, you'll see that she'll have a vent, usually quite a large vent, large hole there, and it looks different to the males. So you can tell that way. It's difficult to tell when they're just chicks. I heard this one trick before, like a 3 or 2 day old quail, how to tell if they're male or female. They reckon if you click your fingers, the males will put their heads up and the females will stay low. That's an interesting thing to try. Look, I've had about 50% success rate just for a bit of fun doing that. The reason why the males go up is apparently because they're more aggressive and they want to see what's going on as a protection measure. Whereas the females obviously want to hide and protect themselves. I don't know. But that's just an off thing. So generally how you tell is from the spots and the collar, and also tipping them upside down, looking at the genitalia. Evan Kinnison. Will the female Courtenay's quail lay just as many eggs with or without a male present? Yes. I've seen no difference with females only and then males with females. They tend to all still lay about the same amount. I could be proven wrong here because this is just from my stock and my observations, and I haven't done any scientific isolation testing to really confirm it. But yeah, as a general observation, I've seen no difference at all, and I have looked for it, and I don't. Lewis Partidia. If the quail eat their own eggs, won't they make a habit out of it? No, they won't. Like, when I'm collecting the quail eggs of a morning, or a daytime, I'm collecting the quail eggs, some of the ones that are really dirty or cracked, I'll just stand on or step on or crush, and then the quail come over and they eat the eggs. But they don't have the strength or the power in the beaks to crack their own eggs. They just don't have that. So they don't turn into egg eaters like chickens can. That's just a myth, that quail can turn into egg eaters if you crush eggs in front of them and they get used to eating eggs. It doesn't happen. Next question, Trey Boom Boom. What do you do with all your eggs? You must have so many of them. Like I said before, we do sometimes eat them, but not a lot of the time. Most of the time we incubate them to make new quail chicks, or we cook them up, feed them to the dog, feed them to the cat, feed them to the chickens, and the ducks love them. Extra protein, extra calcium in the shells. Sometimes we don't even cook them up. I just throw them to the chickens as treats. So that's what we do with all the eggs. Sometimes we get quite a good collection of eggs, and other times we don't. See, we're not commercial operation here, which is one of the beauties, another beauty of being a backyard quail keeper. So through the winter months, even though we live in the subtropics and it's a hot environment, because the daylight hours get shorter, the quail are triggered to have a rest, and they don't lay any eggs for several months until spring again. right? So they have a really good rest, and that's another good thing. A humane way of keeping quail is not putting lights on through the off season and making them continuously lay. I think that's personally cruel. What we do is just leave them go through their natural cycle. And so there's parts of the year where we don't get any eggs at all from our birds. Last question. I am thinking about getting Courtenay's quail. Any tips? Yes, there's plenty of tips, and I can tell you where to find them. On my website, Self-Sufficient Me. Oh, sorry, this is from OG Gaming. Go to my website, selfsufficientme.com, and up the top menu, you'll see the quail section under poultry. So you go to poultry, under poultry, you'll see chicken, ducks, quail. Go to the quail section, you'll see all my writings on quail. I've written several articles on keeping quail, and if you want to ask more questions, simply ask me a question underneath those articles. That's cool. You can either write a question on Facebook directly underneath that article, which I will get, or you can write a question in the standard comment section. Or the other thing you can do is go to our forum, selfsufficientculture.com, and that's a forum that I've created, and go to the poultry quail section there, join up first, and ask a question there, and we'll be happy to answer it for you. And of course, you can go to my channel on YouTube and go to the playlist, which I'll leave in the description and also at the end of this video. Go to the quail playlist and play through my quail videos, and you'll get a really good understanding of them. It's important, you know, they're a great poultry breed to keep, quail, but they are different to keeping chickens and ducks and turkeys and other types of poultry. So it really does pay to research it first before you get into it. And I've got quite a lot of information now built up over the years. Like I said, if you can't find something, a question that you really want answered, if you can't find it in any of that information, well then, just ask me directly, either underneath one of these videos or, like I said, at the forum or on my website in the comment sections, etc., Facebook. Well, that's those 15 questions done. Thanks a lot for listening in. You could have probably listened in. I put a bit of video to this, but you could have just listened in while you did the dishes or something, or were out in the garden gardening. If you like this type of style, me answering some of the questions, it could be on a different subject or whatever, mightn't be just on quail, let me know, and I'll continue doing this, say, you know, once a week or so, sit down and have some question time and answer some of the questions that you give in. Like I said, I love answering your questions. Forgive me if I don't get to them, because there's lots to answer, but this is really what I enjoy doing. So yeah, thanks a lot for watching. Don't forget to give a thumbs up, share this around. Bye for now.